We have our heading.
Here we go!
From the magic within our hearts to the adventure beyond the horizon, there is only one Disney.
They are darling little things. When can the puppies leave their mother?
Never. You're not getting one.
What?
I want the job done tonight.
There they go. Off to the park. Nobody home but the little old cook.
She's watching us, Dad.
Now, who do you suppose?
For the first time on 2-disc Platinum Edition DVD, Walt Disney's 101 Dalmatians.
We gave him a slip, didn't we, Dad?
One of the most beloved Disney classics of all time. Now spectacularly restored with enhanced picture and sound.
It'll be a sensation.
With all new bonus features, including games, a music video, and 101 virtual Dalmatians.
This'll be fun.
Walt Disney's 101 Dalmatians. For the first time on 2-disc DVD. Coming soon, but only for a limited time.
Just wait. You'll be sorry.
What is it about treasure that makes history so fascinating?
Benjamin Gates has spent a lifetime hunting treasures that have been lost to history.
Take a look at this.
But when a secret from the past is uncovered...
Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you one of the missing pages from the diary of John Wilkes Booth.
History will be rewritten.
It's the names of the Lincoln conspirators.
Thomas Gates.
Your great-great-granddaddy planned the assassination.
It can't be.
We cannot have him remembered as a conspirator in the assassination of the man who brought this nation together.
Now.
I need to see the page.
You have 30 seconds to disable the alarm. Go.
You do that in 15 seconds.
That's why I tell people to get a dog.
His search to clear his family's name.
Take a look at this.
It's a cipher.
Clever.
Has uncovered a secret he never expected to find.
There is a book, and it has the information you need. The President's Book of Secrets. A collection of documents for President's eyes only. The truth behind the JFK conspiracy. The missing minutes from the Watergate tapes. And of course, Area 51.
It contains all of our nation's secrets. I need to see the President's book.
The only way you'll ever see that book is if you get elected president.
I'm gonna kidnap him. I'm gonna kidnap the President of the United States.
Wouldn't it just been easier for us to make an appointment?
Code one! Code one!
Gates.
Don't kid yourself what we're capable of.
Every clue leads one step closer.
The letter sent by the Queen.
You're in danger.
You've got to find wherever that leads before they do.
To unlocking the mystery the world isn't ready to believe.
Ben, wait. That could be a horrible trap.
Sorry, I couldn't resist.
National Treasure, Book of Secrets.
Oh, look, my tax dollars at work coming to arrest me.
Thank you.
Summer.
Summer. Summer. Summer.
Summer.
Summer.
Summer.
Summer.
Musical 2, the extended edition, coming soon to Disney DVD and Blu-ray.
This is what I know. Your powers have been given to you for a reason. Your wisdom, your patience, your loyalty are far more important than you can ever understand. The world needs a hero. And man needs a best friend.
You're a cat burglar, huh? Well, I'm not really a cat person. Woof.
Do we have an accord? Marker.
Action!
You can keep Barbosa. The belligerent homunculus and his sticky wooden friend. Yeah.
Set. Still rolling.
Come back.
Parker.
I'll get it this time, I promise.
Don't worry. Set.
Action.
You can keep Barbosa. The belligerent homunculus and his...
Hard a port! Gather way! Keep her trimmed!
Nay, belay that! Do something else!
You can't come.
I don't know how he's going to do it. I'm getting this all wrong completely. Can we start again?
Apologies, Your Majesty. But it's certain the world we know ends today, and I won't be letting the likes of Beckett Cutler... Well, says he's sometimes known Cutler Beckett.
My beer. My darling. My beer.
Someone must ensure that the world turns properly. People are what they...
But that, you can't curse in a Disney film, mate. See? I told him.
Parker.
Mr. Gibbs, is there any particular reason why my ship is gone? The ship?
Square my debt with Jones.
Guaranteed by free. What's in there?
Why didn't you tell me you were planning this?
Sorry.
Buzzy, a bit. Buzzy, had no head.
Quiet, please. And... Sir.
I'm trying to work.
Sir.
I come before you as but a servant. You blew my hat off, you...
Let us not, dear friend, forget our lines. Let us not forget our lines, shall we?
Back to your station, sailor.
And I assure you our intentions are strictly honorable.
And the objects,
it's a strictly honorable. I assure you, our intentions are strictly honorable.
Thinking of putting in French doors, actually. Like a bit of cross breeze.
Sorry, I got caught up.
Thinking of putting in French doors, actually. Like a bit of cross breeze.
Oh, God. Well. Thank you,
sir. And action!
Oh, pfft. Bagger. That's powerful. Do we have any cool? Bagger, that was good.
Joe Kingman is the toughest player to ever take the field. But the star quarterback is about to get his bell rung.
My name is Peyton. I'm your daughter.
Mm-hmm. Hello.
Now, he's going to need
a little bit of bubble bath. I put sparkles on it.
No way. Is Spike wearing a tutu?
Spike!
Dwayne The Rock Johnson.
Want a cookie?
What did you put in the cookie?
Milk, flour, cinnamon.
I'm allergic to cinnamon.
3, 2, 1, go.
Bought the rebels. Get the magic.
The game plan.
Yeah!
Good job.
Coming soon to Disney DVD and Disney Blu-ray.
Get ready for the high-definition event of the year on Disney Blu-ray. Pirates of the Caribbean, Curse of the Black Pearl, and Dead Man's Jest, as you've never seen them before. Two breakthrough hits on two explosive two-disc sets. For the first time in full high definition, experience a picture so clear and sound so real, your home will feel like the deck of the Black Pearl itself.
Stop blowing the holes in my ship!
Then enjoy the ultimate Pirates experience with all new exclusive Blu-ray bonus features. Unlock the mysteries of pirate legend with Scoundrels of the Seas, where for the first time ever, you can create your own documentary while watching the movie.
I like it.
And take on the pirates from the movie yourself in the interactive game, Liar's Dice.
Throw them bones, mates.
It's a world with adventure so real, it can only be called Disney Blu-ray. Start your Blu-ray collection today with Pirates of the Caribbean, Curse of the Black Pearl, and Dead Man's Jest. Yours to own on Disney Blu-ray disc. Magic in high definition. You've heard the tale. Now, live the legend. Pirates of the Caribbean Online. Unleash your character. Captain your ship. Battle your enemies. It's the adventure of a lifetime. PiratesOnline.com.
And that was without even a single drop of rum.
Look over!
The sort of connection that I made with, you know, when I was thinking about Captain Jack was the idea that pirates were the rock and roll stars of that era, you know, of the 18th century. First and foremost, the myth or the legend would arrive months before they would ever make port, you know, that kind of thing, which is very similar to rock and roll stars, you know. And it was about freedom, you know, just...
Now you're talking, Jackie boy.
You know what I mean?
Open the cage, let the tigers out.
It was a long shot, the fact that he agreed to do it. And it was, you know, above and beyond, like a, you know, dream come true kind of thing.
I love it. You having a good time?
Yeah, very much, yeah.
Good.
Keith Richards, you know, is somebody who's a, you know, an icon to all of us, and Johnny based his character partially on Keith.
So that's the reason for all the
I've been aware of, you know, Keith and the stone certainly for a very long time, since I was a kid, and was a, you know, instant huge fan. Keith arrives on set and suddenly every single person from the crew that you have, guys you haven't seen in years, show up, and then they're all standing there just, you know, watching the arrival of the maestro.
I am, I suppose. You know, I mean, I didn't become, you know, everybody out there made me one. You know, I mean,
pleased to meet you, guess you know my name.
Barbarossa is right.
Hang on a minute,
it's Barbosa. Sorry, I got your name wrong. You love it that much? Great, so do I. You know, I mean, bless everybody for it. You know, one love, you know?
I'll be your rodeo choice tonight.
The first time I met Keith Richards, I'm on the pirate ship, and he's walking through a bunch of people. He's dressed completely as a pirate, makeup and everything, holding my guitar. It was appropriately surreal.
Danny Farrington built this beautiful guitar in about a week. Keith playing the guitar and this beautiful, really sweet version of Spanish Ladies.
And then I break it.
Ready? And then the string breaks, exactly.
I'm gonna get me one now. And action.
It felt quite natural to do it, and also the set was so great that it's, you know, I could make records in there.
Being as that Keith was one of the main ingredients for Jack Sparrow, you definitely recognize some Jack Sparrow in there.
Just like that.
With a slow, like you're gonna say.
Everything I do is original. You better believe it.
I think Captain Teague is one of those guys who would, you know, give you a hug, and then the next minute, you know, might blow you away.
The code is the law.
Did you see who I modeled myself on? Unfortunately, he's very large and won't fit in this room. He's somewhere up there, somewhere around, you know. He's so great, he's invisible.
Action!
You're in my way, boy.
You didn't need me at all, man. No, he came in and, you know, did the right thing right away.
I mean, I just turned up and said, boom, I know what to do, he knows what to do. And just see how it bounces off. I mean, I'm the amateur around here, you know what I mean?
Hardly. To take Richard. Stick by that.
Aha.
How's mum? Is that a tongue? How's mum?
She's on the floor. I still can't find that f***ing page, man.
Fantastic.
Yeah. That's great. Below us, we're filming the Maelstrom set for Pirates of the Caribbean at World's End. Biggest action sequence ever attempted.
It all starts on a piece of paper and a napkin. Then 600 very talented men and women come in here and build all this.
We shot it in a warehouse that's the size of a, you know, small city, basically.
I've never been in a building where you have horizon drop off, just looking from one side to the other.
When you walk into that hangar, you've got the two main ships, you've got three or four other ships, and they're all sort of floating around 30 feet in the air.
This is the Super Bowl of the motion picture business right here. We had to design and we had to create this monster in 3 months.
It allowed for a scale that nobody had even thought of. When Gore saw it, he fell in love with it and realized, now I can do what my vision is leading me to do.
Look at that, that is a massive piece of sculpture.
We knew it was going to be huge, but until it was done and we walked there and we looked at the whole thing, it was pretty impressive.
And this was a sequence that went on for about 8 weeks. It was an enormous production.
Let's just take a moment to enjoy the fact that we will never make a film this big ever again in your life. The end of an era, my friend.
Heaviest set ever moved.
As you may see, effects has placed 8 air bearings underneath the set itself.
It'll float on air like an air hockey game, but upside down.
It's air bearings, less air pressure that's in the tire on your cars.
It's not so much moving it, it's controlling it. Once it gets in the air, it kind of wants to do its own thing.
We're going to use the forklifts as a like little tugboats, and they'll just shove it along. So we're lacking water, we're lacking sails, and we're lacking wind, so this is Hollywood's way of moving a boat.
Right now, they shouldn't be tied to the mast, they should just be off the ship.
Gore's a strong proponent of trying to get practical elements on set, to get as much in camera as you can get, and then use visual effects where you really need them.
This cannon right here, let's have Tony hit that.
It's important to have real elements. As much as you can do real, more realistic the final result will be.
Our function as special effects is if it moves or it's in the atmosphere, we do it.
John, so this is not bolted into any sort of floor?
No.
So when this thing tilts over, is there a counterweight or what?
Well, it's all built into it, yeah. It'll be fine.
I asked a very question.
It'll be fine.
What we're kind of doing is just creating a lot of havoc. What we decided to do that has never been done before on any motion picture is put a tower at each end of the ship and be able to heave it up. We could heave it up 15 feet.
And then usually you're not going right straight into the wave. You're going to the side. So you can put a little bit of roll into that. Cool. And then it starts looking real.
It's our understanding that these two gimbals for the Black Pearl and the Flying Dutchman are the largest gimbals that have been built for the film business. To put it in perspective, just think of one ship weighs the equivalent of a 747.
Those big things there are the hinges that get put into here, basically like your very big Lego set, right? You gotta put it together, they attach the hydraulics.
The Pearl requires 1,000 gallons a minute of oil to make it run at speed.
These will supply hydraulic flow to both ships, about 1,000 gallons a minute.
That's almost 10 times the normal amount of oil that you would use on a motion base for a normal motion picture. We had 150 welders working 24/7. There's over 2,000 feet of hydraulic hose. There's over 1 million pounds of steel. This is unheard of.
Logistically, it's huge, huge undertaking.
It's the most lights that have ever been used to light anything ever in the film business. It's like Close Encounters of the Third Kind.
You have two boats that cover 700 by 700 feet square. So if you make it on such a big scale, you're ending up with 1,400 space lights and 9,000-10,000 amp generators and several miles of cable and building catwalks, putting air conditioning so stuff doesn't catch on fire. Theoretically, it's very easy to draw it on the paper, but to get it done, the guys did a remarkable job.
We have the potential here to generate about 105,000 amps of power. You could probably light a small city with that, I imagine.
We definitely want the first shot, they all come aboard there. But maybe we then kind of reset and take a few of these travelers and have a couple of guys and go a little thinner just so we have...
Mix it up a little bit. It doesn't have to be 16 people every time.
Right, exactly. But
you have...
16's nice.
When we're writing, we actually try to think of what would be a challenge to the stunt coordinator, or what would be a challenge to the CGI animators. What is something that they'd read, they go, I want to try to do that.
There's a lot of things going on. It's pretty wild. At first, I thought, well, we can't do big battles on these ships when they're at a 30-degree angle. And we did. rain, wind, smoke, debris, mortars, all of a sudden you'll be doing the most finely tuned choreography and a piece of balsa wood will hit you in the side of the face.
Hey guys, it's Sentimental Night. Last night on the Black Pearl. And I just want to say your spirit and energy made this whole thing come to life. I thank each and every one of you from the bottom of my heart. I love you all, and God bless you.
What an audience doesn't see is how much time all these actors put in behind the camera, the sword fighting, the stunts, things that take weeks and weeks or months to prepare. It looks so simple when you see them clash with those swords, but everything is so choreographed and it's very difficult to learn. It's hard for an actor to stand in front of a blue screen or a green screen and try to recreate what's happening around them. So what Gore has created, he used the real wind, he used the real rain, he used the real ships. So the actor is really feeling and experiencing what the character would be experiencing. And that's what a director wants. He wants a real performance. These characters are feeling it.
This is how Cecil B. DeMille probably did direct. And when we did the sword fights, and there are 160 people sword fighting.
It's kind of brutal. From the first shot, you're pretty much wet all day long.
We went for 3 months.
It's torrential downpour and probably 75 knots of wind in this building.
I call it surviving.
They turn the rain on and you're drenched within about 10 seconds. It's quite challenging.
It certainly makes it feel real.
You can barely move, but you sort of have so much adrenaline on the day that you hopefully rise to the madness of the moment.
Brace on yours, you cackhand, you dickhead! Dial is the day worth living for!
You have all these plans to act and maybe do it rather elegantly, and then they turn the rain machine on. The bad news is all your ideas go out the window. And the good news is that actually it's very authentic because you're in a maelstrom.
Stuff me to get wet.
I just feel sorry for the crew because they're in it all day long.
In terms of whether anybody's angry at us, I just do want to go on record and say we did not add the rain.
The way we treat the blue screen is actually very tricky because we're putting so much rain out there that in certain angles, this blue screen is completely obscured by the rain. But in the same time, if you are in the reality of this maelstrom storm, your visibility will be limited too.
There was a bit of a negotiation with Gore where he wants this very, very dense rain.
I'm concerned in a shot like this, the dynamics are not going to be what you want, then I'm going to be trying to get rid of it.
I was concerned that the blue screen wasn't blue anymore and at times it was going completely gray. I was always arguing for, could we just do a little less?
The very interaction of the rain hitting the masts and the rails of the boats and cannons and dripping from people's faces, I mean, it's the stuff you cannot reproduce. It's a tremendous amount of work for ILM. Fortunately, they're brilliant. And John Knoll is going to pull it off.
It's a wrap on the pearl. It's a wrap on the pearl. It's kind of a wrap on the maelstrom, isn't it? You could say that, although we have a lot of work to do in post.
That final maelstrom battle can't really be created without digital effects. And Gore has an amazing technical background in terms of having been a really accomplished special effects supervisor, and then also all of his commercial shooting before he ever went into feature filmmaking.
I like that camera shake you put in that Johnny shot. He looks a little soft.
When he's dealing with an effect shot at ILM and he's kicking it back for the ninth time, because it's not quite right. The people he's talking with at ILM, he has the same knowledge base, and he can see things in a shot that an average director without that technical background wouldn't see, and it ends up making the movie that much better.
He's very tough on us on the composites and will bust us for very small cheats that we try and do.
We'll make sure he stays sharp. We've been doing a lot of kind of water on the lens like this.
I like it. We should just dodge.
Yeah, keep his face clear.
Critical area. That's just going to make the whole thing so much better.
The whole thing is his movie, you know, and he's involved in every aspect of it. And
just as he might worry about the production design of different elements, you know, he worries about or concerns himself with the visual effects.
The single biggest issue for us was the maelstrom, to put enough detail into it to have the motion look realistic, and that we had to do that for several hundred shots.
The two ships side by side at Palmdale, you know, they were rigged to move opposite each other, and there's a lot of worth in that, particularly with the way the people on the ships reacted and moved to a deck that was actually tilted and so forth, and having the rain come down pouring. But when you were looking from one ship across to the other, it quickly became evident that the two ships didn't move enough separate from one another. So, you know, it became necessary to sort of eliminate the ship in the background and replace it with our CG, Black Pearl or Flying Dutchman, and people it with characters, or to shoot, to use an element of the real ship, but then cut it out and sort of add the right movement to it.
ILM put all their resources into finishing Pirates 2, getting it on time. So when you actually look at like, okay, well now we can start on P3, there wasn't that much time left.
We thought that the first movie had a lot of effects shots in it, and this is probably three times that.
John O and ILM had a really difficult task. In the third movie, there were over 2,000 visual effects shots.
Virtually everyone in the facility was working on the film at the same time. It was the first time that had happened at ILM since Return of the Jedi.
Do you feel this?
In Pirates 2, Davy Jones was the star, the character that we needed to integrate into many different scenes. And in Pirates 3, we had an additional star, which was the Maelstrom.
The carrots we've had!
Maelstrom!
I love this shot.
It looks so real. It's just, it's a little bit with how the camera is animated as well, but it just feels like there are big waves out there and they're moving slowly. And there's no water here. There's just a plate in the foreground. There's nothing. The tricky part was actually how to make the whole maelstrom spin around.
We've looked at a lot of, you know, big wave anomalies. We've looked at, 60-foot waves, studied how water moves and how it accelerates as it kind of comes up to the lip. And we're just, you know, trying to create something that we buy, that we believe.
When you see a wave, there's this incredibly complicated thing going on. It's not a simple process. You've got all the water molecules and everything is kind of interacting and it's creating foam and spray and mist and all sorts of chaos is happening. We at ILM have a team working at Stanford and we've use those guys to try and analyze those kind of problems and come up with solutions. How do you create water? And it required a massive amount of computing time. I mean, it was just mind-blowing. It's not just something where you go, yeah, you know, that kind of looks okay. You know, it doesn't really work like that. You're trying to create this iconic moment in the movie.
That's a good example right there. You know, the ship that takes the inside lane is moving faster and getting an advantage on the ship that's got the outside lane. So the water itself has to be moving faster inside than outside.
You can sort of see that the Black Pearl is going closer in or more towards the center where there's a faster band of water. Now that was, of course, very, very hard to simulate.
And they've had to go back and rework the Maelstrom, keeping in mind that, you know, there's a story to be told here.
What's happening in the foreground is pretty complicated as well. There's a gigantic battle happening between the crew of the Black Pearl and the crew of the Flying Dutchman. So we have computer-generated characters in the midst of lots of rain and atmospherics and splintering wood. And so these things are kind of difficult to integrate and make them really look like they're present. During the Maelstrom sequence, Captain Jack Sparrow and Davy Jones engage hand-to-hand combat on the top of the yardarms of the big Flying Dutchman vessel. Johnny Depp and a stunt guy portraying Davy Jones actually fought hand-to-hand on a portion of a set they built, basically a yardarm as well as a crow's nest. That allowed Gore to direct the action as well as create most of the camera moves on set. We then took those shots and then fleshed out the world around it. Sometimes we retained almost everything they shot from the set pieces, the yard arm and the crow's nest. Sometimes we replaced them completely. We always kept Johnny Depp's performance because it's really important that the audience see him acting and engaging with Davy Jones up there.
Oh,
but it definitely was a challenge to try to build this world around them as well as make it all believable.
When that shot starts, it starts off as a completely digital shot.
We start with a digital version of Johnny Depp at the beginning of the shot, primarily because the camera move was so long and extensive. So we do a transition from our digital Johnny into our practical double right there. So before this rigging piece flies across camera, this is our digital Johnny Depp. And as soon as it flies past, then it becomes Johnny Depp on set. And everything else is computer graphics. So we even replaced the yardarm that they were standing on set because it was easier than trying to integrate our model with it.
There's a little series of shots coming up next, and we've taken one of our guys and made a little story. These were the shots where we had some guys just kind of laying around doing nothing in the background. So we've got that guy there. He's got a sword stuck in his back, and he's trying to get at it, and then he pulls it out. And nobody's ever going to notice it except on the DVD, but he's fallen back there.
No, it's fantastic.
He gets up. He's trying to reach that hilt behind him. And then he finally gets it out just before the cut on this shot. So I don't think anybody's going to see it.
It's better than just guy laying on a cannon, that's for sure. Great.
The schedule is really what made everything 100 times more difficult, just trying to get that level of complexity and that number of shots through the pipe in the amount of time that we had. It was really challenging.
It looked pretty much impossible. I was really worried that there was no way to get this done in time, at least not looking good. There were a lot of sleepless nights, there was a lot of worrying, a lot of strategizing about how we're gonna do this. And the crew really worked very hard. They poured their souls into this.
It'd be too late to order the cars now, ladies.
The really exciting thing, I think, sometimes about working on the big scale, the Bruckheimer, the Gore Verbinski movies, is the scale of these things, that you can have these amazing moments in a movie where just a tremendous amount of effort has been put into this one moment and the richness of that moment.
I think it feels like you're actually there. It feels like this was done in camera, but in fact, it's a melange of all those things. Little bits and pieces of it are in camera. A lot of it is digital effects. And the intersection between those two is basically seamless. It's a testament to Gore and John Fraser and Derek Walsky, the director of photography, and the whole effects department. I mean, you know, these guys are winning Academy Awards for a reason. And it's just amazing what they pulled off on those stages.
The success of a picture is because of an enormous amount of people who work very hard on it. It's not easy to do. When it's done well, it looks easy.
Said, you know, how do we keep it unexpected? We said, let's just get weird. Jack Sparrow is commanding a ship of 100 Jack Sparrows, and it's what we call a multiple Jack sequence, where Johnny plays many versions of Jack Sparrow throughout the ship.
Oh! Pull the sheets handsomely, boys! Scandalizing the team!
It's like slicing him up into a pie, in a way, you know, and the major ingredients of that person, you know, have been separated. So you get the extreme version of fear, rage and aggression, anger. It was a great challenge, you know.
We have lost speed and therefore time, precious time, which cannot be recovered once lost. Do you understand?
It's just keeping a line on what particular version of Captain Jack, you know, keeping a handle on that and then making it different.
Help.
Johnny would play himself in many ways. So you had to rehearse the entire sequence, character by character, and then lay in the different Johnnies or different Jacks.
Four goes, five, six, and
initially it was shot with another actor reading the off-screen line, the Alba Jack lines, so the rhythm could be determined with another actor.
Mr. Sparrow.
I am.
What say you about the condition of this tack line?
What was really, really helpful was on the day when they were able to do these kind of ghost mix where you see the two Jacks interact and they add the third and the image fades a little bit more, but you get to see the interaction between the three. When you see it's working, it juices you up, you know.
Let's try one more.
Action!
It's tedious.
Inch back a little bit on the mark.
How's it?
Action!
Tedious.
Let's just shoot one more real quick.
Camera's just repeating the same move over and over. Well, it takes forever.
That goes in the record books as one of the weirder days.
You know, he has the opportunity to be a bunch of different characters in this, and he has these voices that he's constantly responding to, so he even makes them more engaging that you get more and more of Jack in this one.
Slacking braces! Aye, Captain! Slacking braces! Step lively!
Gore and Johnny had so much fun coming up with these little vignettes of the multiple Jacks throughout this sequence. Chicken Man is one of our favorites, I think.
He has balance issues.
Not very subtle.
There are 12 identical Jack Sparrows.
This is Jack.
Jack Sparrow 3.
We've had 8 or 9 of them walking around identically dressed at any time.
It wasn't distracting at all.
Captain Jack Sparrow, mate.
No, I'm Jack Sparrow. I'm sensing a lot of deja vu at the moment.
It's also quite funny to be on the lot when they're shooting this scene because they had about 10 or 15 guys dressed up like Jack Sparrow.
Captain Jack Sparrow.
Jack Sparrow.
I'm probably Jack farthest from the camera.
You could walk onto the stage and think you were going crazy.
This is going a little. I'm Jack.
I'm one of 5 Jacks.
I'm Spartacus.
One of our 3 versions of multiple Jacks in the story is the 2 little Jacks on the shoulder of Johnny. We created the large dreadlock set, which was in essence his wig.
When Gore first told me about the dreadlock set, it sounded like a really cool idea, and we did a number of different versions of beads in here until we got it right for him.
If you lean out and kick your feet, you know, if it's one of those kind of things, yeah. Even, you know what might sell it best? His rotation.
This way, Johnny had something to interact with. He had a dreadlock to interact with. He can actually push. At times, he wanted the little Johnny to push through dreadlocks to appear. He'd be hanging from a dreadlock. He'd be swinging.
I feel good. I like it. The thing that keeps us leaving the body.
The immortal Captain Sparrow.
What about that? All the reactions had to be quite different, you know, different levels for all these different characters that I've played. I enjoyed it. I mean, you know, it was a lot of fun to play.
Gentlemen, I wash my hands of this weirdness.
See, you neglected to properly take care of my ship.
Well, this? She's ventilating. Clear out the stench of the previous occupant. Thinking of putting in French doors, actually.
Like a bit of cross breeze.
Heading, Captain.
2 degrees starboard.
I'm Captain of the starboard side. 2 degrees starboard. The Captain will now take the helm.
Aye, Captains.
I see you neglected to properly take care of my ship.
Well, this? She's ventilating. Clear out the stench of the previous occupant. Thinking of putting in French doors, actually.
Like a bit of cross breeze.
Heading, Captain.
2 degrees starboard.
I'm captain of the starboard side. 2 degrees starboard. The captain will now take the helm.
Aye, captains.
Martin Clever, and I played Pirate Marty. Hey, bro, what's going on?
Nothing.
Another day at work?
Yeah. You got cars?
My custom chopper, the Black Pearl. The engine's a 480cc Vanguard. Got Johnny Depp on the gas tank. Everything is custom made. Carburetor's a Harley Davidson carburetor. Totally street legal. It'll do about 90 to 100 miles an hour with me on it. It's pretty good, eh? I first started P2, and I was thinking about doing a bike, something cool. And then I said, well, would it be cool if I did something piratey? I wanted it to look like a, you know, kind of a timepiece, kind of like the movie. That's my baby. I've seen my bike, I've seen my car.
Anyway, nice wheels.
Thank you, man.
Have a good day at work.
You too, bro. Have a good one.
Is he that terrifying?
It's much like myself, but absent my merciful nature and sense of fair play. Welcome to Singapore.
Selfang. 他是一个海盗王嘛，在新加坡的王，他都是活跃在南中国海一带。
The reason that the Chinese actually became pirates, they were most of them were fishermen, and the only way they could get ahead was to pirate.
Who are you?
Tai Huang. These are my men.
They developed this kind of reputation for fierceness. Because they had to. It was the only way they could survive.
So, the only way a pirate can make a profit is by betraying other pirates.
I can live with that.
海盗出卖海盗是正常的, 所以他是当一个买卖。
That's just good business.
Chow Yun-fat is a masterful actor. He's an international star.
He's like the biggest movie star in China, right? So, relatively, he's the biggest movie star in the whole wide world because of the amount of people, you know? He has a godlike status in that country.
This is a mega movie star that we all kind of idolize him.
Ready, action!
His work is spectacular. He has a great work ethic.
We worked well together. He picked things up. He had definite ideas about his character. He came in with definite things that he wanted to accomplish character-wise, and we made some adjustments to what we had laid out.
Come
on. How's that? Chow Yun-fat brought his own stunt double from Hong Kong, Bai Wai Wong, I believe his name is. And they had an unusual way of working where we would demo everything with his double. And I would suggest, well, you want to start working on this? And he goes, no, we'll do this at the hotel. He discovered the moments that were important to him within the choreography, within the fight, within his character. And that's what he wanted to concentrate on. But he knew it all.
No other treatment would be worthy of you. Calypso.
Excuse me?
不要告诉我的太太。
Can I have one more, please?
It's so funny because you meet this guy and he's a clown. He's like a total goofball.
So I can make him back.
Myself!
I'm sorry.
And markers!
Honestly, not in the DVD, okay?
He made us feel comfortable, and I think that was great that he did that.
Actually, he hugs all the actors. He hugs the background. He hugs Gore. He hugs everybody. He comes on set. Oh, I said, what do you want me to call you? He said, Fat Go. In China, Fat would be his first name. Go means older brother. So I thought, okay, yeah, you're my captain.
Because I'm a fan of the pirates, so I went with them together. It was like a child walking into the dream and seeing what I liked. So walking with them together, it was like
特别过瘾，特别开心。Like when we get into the lives, I think this should just all be the effects, don't you?
Is that what you want in there?
Yes. Here we go.
Hines is another one of those artists that always comes up with something fresh and unique and different. He's a, you know, a brilliant composer who has these wonderful melodies in his head. You look at the Pirates theme, which you hear everywhere now. And for the third one, he created a whole bunch of new themes.
Play the downbeat of 180.
Hans has developed new themes for each of the subsequent films. Some of those themes carry into the third film that were developed for Pirates 2. There are lots of brand new themes.
I sat down and wrote over an hour's worth of new tunes. You know, it's the third one, so we want to do a really good job, and we have all these ideas that we've been talking about for, what, 3 years or so.
It could be sweetened synthetically with a, you know, a detuned piano. Yeah. Right. One note, bow. Yeah.
There's a far more eclectic sort of landscape to the movie. I think that's part of the strength of these movies, that we keep showing you worlds that you've never quite seen before. And we give you sounds that you've never heard before.
Okay, this part of our meeting is come up with ideas about other instruments. Since I already said things like banjo, it should open it up to that anything stupid you say will be hailed as a masterpiece. I mean, don't be shy. I just think we can take it a lot further than the last movie.
On this one, I'm far more active with using instruments that aren't part of the orchestra. So it does feel more like a journey, like you're truly going to the end of the world and beyond.
Next thing is like the big theme for me.
Okay. The love theme?
Well, it's actually the. It's just the theme of the whole movie. So, a world premiere, as it were.
One of the things I think which is different in this movie, that we found a theme that binds the movie together, that takes you on this journey. At the same time, I think all journeys are inherently romantic. And so, yes, I am using it for, I'm using it as a love theme. If you ever analyze it, you know, there's a, like a twist of the Johnny theme in it, which is counterimposed against the main notes of all the other themes tumbling down into hell, da 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 da. By the time I put this in front of the orchestra, all I'm worried about is that it's unplayable or it'll sound like nothing that I imagined in my head. And so it's really them that remind me, you know, after they've done a take where I was just holding my breath, you know, hoping my heart won't stop, hope there weren't any horrible accidents going to happen out there, that I can hear them having enjoyed it. I can go, oh, okay, I've written something that they actually can get their teeth into, and it elevates it straight away because they can find some sort of an emotional connection with it. That's why I love working with musicians, because that's what they do. They give you the gift of their heart.
Yeah, 25. Is that, you said to play out, we can do that.
Da, 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 da. You could just let it sing more, the whole thing.
It's wonderful to watch him when he has, you know, 80 musicians and how he talks to each individual violinist to tell him exactly the pitch and the tone and the feeling that he wants. And then you add him the editors to a director who's as brilliant as Gore Verbinski. It makes it all kind of come together.
I actually was like, where's the death toll?
Right.
Because we talked about that.
Because it's so low. Yeah.
And like, I was like, so oh, it's there, but it, you know, right. I know I'm searching for it.
The reason I didn't want to be in rock and roll anymore or didn't want to be in a band anymore is because all you do is you talk about music. But what happens with filmmakers is very often they will ask or describe something in a way that has nothing to do with, you know, the language of music, but it sparks notes in you straight away. It,
ooh, right, more those units could come in.
But we have a boom into it.
Yeah, we've had a wonderful, like, dialogue with music throughout the cutting process with the composer Hans Zimmer just down the hall.
When they start hanging is when it should start suspending.
I think you're right.
Yeah.
We'd be able to get tracks into the system, talk about them, have meetings. He'd make adjustments and we'd get adjusted versions.
It really helps to kind of pre-visualize how, you know,
the finished film will be.
Right, where we're going with it.
It depends on the background play, but it seems like we could take a tail trim on the end of that shot.
The Avid and electronic editing has made me rethink how we do it. And rather than starting at the end of a project, why not start at the beginning while they're shooting? And why not start giving the editors music early, because it will inspire them and things will come together and you very quickly find out what doesn't work as well.
I'm saying I can play any tune through that texture. I just like the high thing and...
If you end up doing that, use that instead of
some of these things go completely wrong. We have, you know, I mean, you know, this is the stuff we never talk about. When you write something and you, you know, you really believe in it and it goes completely wrong.
The descending into the splash,
yeah,
sort of feels like it's working and then it goes da 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 da. So it kind of womp 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 instead of
that Gork doesn't stand up in the middle of this and go, oh my God, you're ruining my movie. You know, I mean, I think that takes character. I met Gore when he was doing Mouse Hunt, and we did Weatherman together, Pirates 2.
This is the Zimmer process.
We have everybody in the room waiting.
That's fine.
And he's right on the
Casio. Hey, what do you think about this for Jack?
No, I think it's good. Let's get it.
It really isn't a shorthand with Gore because he's a stickler for detail. All that happens is then I try to outdo him with detail. I try to go even crazier on my orchestration, or, you know, I try to find a musician in Mongolia that he guaranteed hasn't heard of, or something like that. So we have all these these cultural references and, you know, our Fellini movies, Armor Court, and we analyze things to great levels. But the form of it, I think, is good.
Yeah, but that's going to work, right? The high note of the cross.
Right. That's what makes it so fun for me, because I'm dealing with somebody who understands my obsession about certain things and who seems to have a similar taste.
We're just about to record Igor Verbinski playing the guitar. Why is he playing the guitar? Number one, because the part was written for him. Number two, because he can. Number three, because it's probably going to save the movie. And number four, because we're getting a little low on budget.
He's a really good guitar player. Actually, it was interesting to do this sort of role reversal where suddenly I was the director and he was reacting the way I was reacting by being insecure.
It's too much gain, huh? The headphones are too hot now. I mean, I can't get any more distortion.
No, but
everything's on 10.
He was saying, look, if it's no good, you can get somebody else. Look, I've said that to him 1,000 times.
I'm loving that I don't have to fire you. It's great.
Actually, Gore gave me a big gift at the end of the last movie, and he doesn't even know this. He said to Melissa, our music supervisor, he said, when Hans sits down and just plays his moody chord, something special happens. And I forgot, when I play really simply, it's very effective, you know, but there's a thing that happens, you know, where, you know, you get carried away with all the stuff on the screen and you start to get complicated. You know, he just reminded me, you know, if I just do Hans, simple, moody, you know, German. It's very effective, it's very emotional.
3 or 4 notes can make a brilliant melody, and that's what I believe in. I believe in very simple, strong melodies.
I do think we have a sound that nobody else has, and nobody else had, and even though it's humorous, it's pretty tough. I thought we were going to make the Bikers Pirate movie. I was substituting the ships for Harley Davidson motorcycles in my mind. So there's always a rock and roll sensibility in it.
Hans has done a magnificent job to create probably the boldest and most romantic themes.
Yeah. Epic sounding score.
I never forget what a great opportunity I have. People are asking me to write music. Wow, this is what I wanted my life to be about. So, you know, lucky me. Thank you. Anybody who has any records or any CDs has one album that Simon has played on. I said to him, oh, you know, I want to do some drums. I'm going to bring this guy Simon Phillips in. And guys go, Simon Phillips, oh my God. He took over for Keith Moon for The Who. I mean, that's an impossible job. I know we met on sessions in London, and he was just a legend. So I probably didn't even speak to him because I would be so shy. But he played on The Lion King for me, all sorts of things.
It's been a long time since I've done a film date, especially one like this, where they're kind of cues.
How did that feel?
I don't know how long it's been since I've counted bar 202.
I do it all the time.
It's just so alien to rock and roll or jazz or playing in a song form.
You know, and there's nothing that daunts him. And at the same time, there's a fire and there's a ferocity in his playing. He'll go right to the edge of where it becomes dangerous. that's what I like. I like people who push things out just a little too far.
Johnny's got an idea about the little Charlie Chaplin, the tramp. Uh-huh. So he's going to find a peanut on the rail of the Black Pearl. He's going to, you know, put the peanut out here, get ready to cut it and eat it. He's got his napkin on, a beautiful dinner. And today, we're serving salted peanuts.
This is too much.
Let's go! Come on, let's get some nuts!
Peanut vibe.
The perfect peanut has to have a little nub on the end, a little node. It's like an umbilical cord.
Can we get a stuntman to do this?
And the key to poking it is you can't do it too hard. You have to just nudge it slightly, and it'll be there. It'll be on the fork for you. You can't force it.
Yeah, it's a good position. Oh, I see.
He's too roly-poly, sorry. He's gonna fly.
It's a highly technical performance. They're very quiet on set.
Oh, how's that?
Bolt, you were peanut.
And hold on.
Navigation of Giants.
It's called a Chinese allegory map, or the Saofeng map.
Saofeng has these. He hands them off to Will at Singapore.
He has his charts.
It plays a very key role because it's the whole reason they get to find Jack Sparrow. It's basically a map to the other world, to Davy Jones' locker.
The route to the farthest gate.
Is it solving a mystery?
We want are saying
that's why the profound map was created. Yeah, that's right.
That's now the moment.
We had a big meeting. Gore knew it was important, so Gore brought everybody into the room. Crash and Chris and Rick and John and everybody, and we threw out all these crazy ideas, like maybe it's lit from underneath and it projects stars, maybe it's an origami, maybe it's the globe that expands from a Chinese lantern. One of the references was sort of a ring-type map that everybody liked. But at the end of the meeting, we're like, let's go with the globe idea. It's like, okay, the globe.
I went and I got a Chinese lantern, and I started painting on it, and it started feeling like a National Geographic crafts project. It didn't have the coolness of, like, a big map.
And it just looked dumb. It just didn't work.
So, this is not necessarily the illustration, but it's just, like, the feeling of having a cool map.
So there's an area on the map, which is the physical world, but then beyond that, I was thinking it needs to have realms that aren't in the physical world.
It's almost like a big combination lock.
It looks one way, you turn it, it makes sense to something here.
That's right.
But then when you only rotate one section, these still make sense, but it adds another element.
In a way, it's like, you know, the nine rings of Hades, but it's much more physical. It starts, the middle of the map would be literal geography. And then it starts to expand to realms that are a little more metaphysical.
This is the real world, this is the inner world, this is the transition between the real world and the dead world. Now you're in the dead world. How do you get out?
By the end, you get out into this celestial realm.
It's not getting to the land of the dead that's the problem. It's getting back.
Gore knew he wanted a shot of a phrase being revealed.
What's cool about this kind of writing, that's maybe the thing that you should rotate, is this kind of writing written over a line.
And I was thinking, but if it's so obvious that it's the same typeface, that's not much of a secret, because that clearly would line up. And I thought, oh, well, you disguise it as Chinese. So when you rotate them together, it becomes English. But,
exactly.
But before that, it looked Chinese.
Nice.
They are rotating the rings and trying to line different rings up to reveal phrases.
As you rotate this, it's just that simple.
And he loved it, but he was like, shouldn't, when the rings turn, shouldn't the shapes of the countries become something else? And I thought, yeah, it should become a Chinese dragon. And then I just started doing a bunch of tests. I cut out a bunch of rings and just started drawing and seeing how interesting shapes would line up with each other. Sometimes the land formations line up just to be land formations, but then sometimes they line up to actually be magic shapes.
Oh, here's something else that's cool, is the dragon. You see the dragon that forms now?
This is actually real blood. I poked myself, so I just thought I'd dip it. And then I augmented it, I think with, this is ink, but some of this is real blood, and then you can, these are actually my fingerprints in blood. So my blood went into this map. Originally, we were hoping to actually make a paper version of the map, like origami, that would turn.
But, you know, with the humidity that we have down here, which is a lot of the challenge we had, was to, you know, find something that wasn't gonna be affected by the elements. So we have these brass rings that all lift up like that.
Yeah, it seems way more complex than it should be, but once you realize that the weather can affect it so much, you get to a point where the rings probably wouldn't turn anymore. It was ridiculous. Don't ever do that at home. The map has a few close-ups, so we had to create the entire map fully detailed in all areas because certain secrets are revealed.
See, the problem, you want the eyeball to be the solution. The actual rolling answered the riddle.
The eyeball rolls past.
Yes.
We tilt up, you're kind of zoned out. You then reach down and turn this.
This is sort of a crucial part because we knew that it was gonna sort of become something else.
Up is down. That's just maddeningly unhelpful.
He also notices that the boat itself in the center, if you turn it upside down, that sort of inspires him because that's a clue in itself.
And that's where you turn the inner rib. This ship goes upside down.
Yeah. Not sunset. Sundown. Then rise.
If you're clever enough, if you study it enough, it will take you to places that you can't get any other way.
We're good and lost now. For certain, you have to be lost to find a place that can't be found.
And that sort of is a whole theme in Pirates, which is the more modern the world gets and the more efficient it gets, we start losing some of the magic and losing some of the connection with these metaphorical realms that humans used to be able to go into a lot more easily than they can today.
Gentlemen, I wash my hands of this weirdness.
Of being one of the first people in the creative process when a film's being made. What I'll do is come in and sit down with Gore and he'll describe scenes, characters, and it's usually something that needs to be developed and conceptualized because it doesn't exist in our world.
Maybe this look and this could be combined, you know, so that it's he's holding this with, you know, with the right hand.
Pirates 1 had the cursed pirates, the skeletons. In 2, one of the first things that he said was, you know, we got to come up with the new curse. And one day he had scribbled a little drawing. It was just like this little pirate with a clamshell in his eye. And he goes, I'm thinking like this. Like, what if they were just kind of living on the bottom of the ocean all this time? Initially, you know, when I was designing these characters, it was just kind of a conglomeration of, you know, shells and mollusks and sea anemones. We realized that we had to kind of start focusing on one element to really make these characters stand out individually. It's funny, you look at the expanse of the ocean, you think, oh my gosh, there's just millions of ideas, but there are only a few really good ideas, you know? The jellyfish head guy didn't quite work, you know, and sea slug face actually made it in, I think.
I like sea anemone mouth guy. Because, well, what did he say? There's something.
The challenge becomes, how do you integrate, you know, certain elements into it and still make it look cool and not make it look like something goofy? So it was kind of matching the fish or creature to the body type and personality. You really didn't want to lose that human aspect because they were once people. And if they become too fish-like, then they just become too creature-y and you stop believing that they were an actual human being. The hammerhead guy, even though, you know, it's got a hammerhead, you know, head, the rest of the body still has that human aspect.
To the captain's cover!
The pufferfish guy, you know, just half of his face is part of that fish, and the rest of his body, you know, was a lot of looking at Howard Pyle kind of paintings and that keeping the costume integral to what was going on and to the character as well. When we first started designing and talking about the cursed crew, Gore said, you know, we got to come up with the captain of this crew and the ship. And that was a very intimidating, you know, thought, because we knew he had to be bigger and command much more, you know, attention and power than the rest of these guys we were designing.
I am the sea.
One of the crew guys I'd come up with had some tentacles coming off of his chin. And Gore said, oh, that's kind of cool. It looks kind of like a beard or something. And immediately I thought of Blackbeard and, you know, how intimidating that guy looks with this big, giant beard and, this, you know, just this attitude. And an image popped into my mind. And I said, I got it. I know what it is. And I went home, and this was the drawing I'd done. Everything kind of fell into place, you know, giving him kind of a peg leg with a crab leg and, you know, one crab claw that he could kind of grab somebody with. Even the hat is kind of a different hat. It's got like horns, you know, devilish. Everything about him referenced something classic about a pirate captain. Gore looked at the piece and he was just like, he was sucked into it. He just goes, man, that's the captain of this ship.
Full bore and into the abyss!
You could see him at the bow of the ship, you know, and the wind blowing his coat, and it became more than just a study. It became really who this character was.
I cannot be summoned like some mongrel pup.
I feel real blessed to be able to have a job and do what it is that I love to do. To me, it's a privilege. Anytime an artist can make a living at doing their art, when you get to work with someone like Gore, it does become an emotional experience, and you feel like you're a part of something that is going to be around for a very long time.
So there's planks across, you know, play with it a little bit.
Even though it's just a movie, you know, it means everything to me. And the pride I feel when I see an actual drawing, you know, projected on screen, the way I drew it initially is the biggest form of compliment you could possibly ever get.
Thank you. Singapore. Point.
I'm Rick Heinrichs. I'm the production designer on Empires 2 and 3. We're on the set of Singapore. It's a set that is sort of kicking off our Pirates 3 shooting. The actors are coming tomorrow, so it gives me a time to come in and kind of give you an idea of what we're doing here. In the process of working with Gore, we get a sense of place and character from him. We'll come up with conceptual drawings which actually just give a feel to the place. One of the earliest drawings we did was a picture of a woman in a boat under a forest of stilts that described the water-based introduction to Singapore that we had in mind. And it was kind of from that inspirational sketch that we took things to the next step and the next step. We're at the Bridge of Sighs corner of Singapore. Yeah. I call it that because we've got these wonderful sort of crowning bridges that overlap across each other. This is where Elizabeth first enters the set. It's a good way of seeing from the water level how the huts are towering over you. The forest of stilts underneath it gives you a sense of how sort of rickety everything is and reinforces our sense of unease and exoticism that accompanies her entry into this world. Singapore is actually geographically in a crossroads of Asia, and at the time that our movie takes place, there were a lot of influences from the area, Indonesian influences, Chinese, Malaysian. Behind me is one of the land-based alleyways that characterize our architecture here. A lot more of this architecture is actually elements that we have pulled out of a lot of Chinese reference from the 18th century, 17th century. The marketplace and the human activities and restaurants and feeding and all of that go on as a background to the action that we're going to be having. We like to strive for as much reality as possible. The spices and mushrooms and fennel and sugar and cinnamon, and we've also got a great deal of fish and crabs. Some of them are fake and some of them are actually real fish. Something like this, I mean, you just can't manufacture that. The bathhouse is kind of a nasty example of hygiene. We've got a lot of mushrooms growing out of the tubs. There'll be a lot of people, in fact, with mushrooms on their shoulders, covering their faces. When the water comes out, we'll add some thickeners to it and color to it, and it's gonna look rather unwholesome. The main Chinese pirate is played by Chow Yun-Fat. This is going to be his spa, with a sense of a history and an imperial dragon behind, give him a sense of majesty and command.
More steam.
We knew that we were going to need to have steam coming up through him, that there were going to be gaps between the boards. Allowed us to kind of have fun with the character of the boards. So one of the fun things that we did was design the entire floor to have a meandering planked look to it. We're down underneath the bathhouse now. This is where all of the steam gets pumped into the bathhouse. There's a big boiler here. All the pipage you see is delivering water to the tubs and steam to the air and oil and everything wonderful for our day spas up there. The fun that we had with this is just, once again, creating a sense of moisture and fungus. And in fact, I'm looking around, I'm thinking we need more mushrooms down here. This is a good place for more mushrooms. I'll be giving that note to somebody right away. It's just been a wonderful design process and such a pleasure to actually stand on a set with all of these kind of primal, natural forms of life, water, stone, wood. I just don't often get the opportunity to work with those things in such an integrated and splendid way that I feel that the set's turned out as. Thank you.
I went to meet Johnny Depp in 03, I think, or maybe even 02. And we began to talk about his costume for Jack Sparrow, and I asked him what kind of pirate he wanted to be. And he said, I want to be a rock and roll pirate. And I said, okay, have you got anybody in mind? And he just said, this is between you and me, but I want to be Keith Richards. Keith Richards' character is the keeper of the pirate book.
I call on Captain Teague, keeper of the code.
Code is the law.
We sort of decided that he didn't go out on the open seas plundering. He was more of a stay-at-home-in-the-castle kind of pirate. We wanted to make him more elaborate. You know, it is Keith Richards after all. So Johnny's costume is much more of a working guy pirate, and this is a bit of an aristocratic pirate. A year ago, Celeste and I went to meet him to measure him. But just because we knew he was going on tour and to save time, we took 6 silk pre-made garments with us to see which shapes work best, which colors work best, what he liked. And he actually chose a navy blue silk damask coat. And it had this embroidery, which had been an old altar cloth that we'd cut round and laid on. But unfortunately, when we showed the director, he didn't like the color. So I called someone I knew at the flea market in Paris, and she sent us a box of old silk damask curtains. And I think at this point Celeste was, you know, ready with the knife on the wrist, because we needed a photo double and possibly a stuntman. So we had to make 3 identical costumes from scratch. And there's never enough materials. This is almost a patchwork coat from 3 sets of curtains, so that she could make 3 identical ones.
And the fabric had to be dyed.
It had to be dyed because it was too red. On camera, it would have been orangey red, and we wanted a bluer red.
I had to cut the fronts and then mark all the fronts and everything that has to be marked out and then sent to the embroiderer with a sample so that he can then embroider it all on the fabric. Then
he embroiders it with a computerized machine. He scans the pattern, and then he digitally applies the embroidery.
The lace was an antique piece, and that is one of the things that we weren't able to multiply, so we did have to make it so we could exchange it between his shirts.
I think this was a stray piece of velvet. It's actually painted velvet. It's not embossed as it looks. We didn't see Mr. Richards again until the week before he shot. So then we showed up again with actually a completely different costume. But he remembered the embroidery. He was really delighted we kept that as part of the costume. And I think he was a very, very happy boy. He loved being dressed up. He felt like a real pirate. And I think he wore it rather well.
Pirate's code.
The pirate code book. Pirate code book was something when we got our hands on the script and I read it. You know, I thought, what an opportunity. I knew that, you know, Gore is very detail oriented and I wanted to give him options to shoot. I knew that there was things meant to be in a code book, parlay, that's in the script that had to be in there.
Parlay.
And then the scripted line that we had about, you know, the pirate king being able to call war. And also, there was a pirate code, like Blackbeard had a pirate code, and a few of the other pirates of that time had them. And for the most part, they kind of said the same thing. You know, it was like, you know, whoever spots the ship first gets the first gun, you know, the best of the pick. Musicians must play every day, but Sunday. If you're marooned, you get a gun with one shot, that kind of thing. So those are things that we put into the pirate code book.
This is an actual old book that a friend of mine had. But I'm going to have these refabricated and we'll put them on this. That's what I like. I just want to run it past you.
I think the writers were talking about something like this, and Gore's like, no, it's got to be huge.
These are fantastic locks. Yeah, if you can go in there.
Uh-huh.
Yeah,
tonight.
So we're going to do this and this with these clasps, and then we'll come up with something cool in the middle.
There was elements where leather was ripped off and the binding and the wood underneath it. The old methods were, you know, the wood was exposed and you could see how they did it. And also there was, you know, the paper, the vellum or the parchment that we were going
to
use.
The paper is supposed to be like vellum, you know, which the original, what they used to use is vellum is actually from the intestines of sheep.
We had a meeting with Gore, and Jerry happened to be there, and I was just trying to get some information from Gore, and this is in the very preliminary stages of the book.
Now this we have to work on, because that's too contemporary.
No, this is just the sizes off. Gore's like, no, it's got to be this, and
there's just scribbles here and stuck pages. And
Jerry chimes in, yeah, you got to have, you know, recipes for rum.
There's like a recipe for rum in there or something.
Absolutely. No. That's what the pirates would do. They would keep their rum recipe right next to their duties of the king thing, you know?
And the brothel in Singapore.
In Singapore, you have a name, Rosie's Tavern, right. You know, and with some X's or something, right. You know?
Arabic, Chinese writing.
Did they have lipstick in those days?
A lot of that is already in here.
Where?
A lot of that in this, within this.
No, I mean, in this page.
All right.
I walked away from that meeting a little beat up, and I was like, boy, I wasn't ready for that. So I said, you know what, next time I show him this book, it's going to be done. So I got our standby painter, Tony Leonardi.
I got to get to work.
And Jim Burkett, who's a conceptual artist.
So usually I work right next to Gore, and we sketch a lot. And then Chris Peck asked me to help on this super prop.
We came up with some little stick figure hobo type drawings, and he would do these in the corner, and we would tear the book and then we would sew it back up, and we'd take a torch and burn it, and through the seam or something, or the hole of the burning, you could actually see some of these stick figures or how to attack a ship, you know, or something like that.
This is actually a map to the rum locker that some desperate pirate put together. Shows you how to walk 10 paces from the palm tree to the rum locker. It's probably the most valuable thing in the code book.
Welcome to the Caribbean.
In here, it tells you who the pirate lords are, what their pieces of eight are, what seas they are a pirate king to, and the lords, and how a pirate lord becomes king. And all those things are revealed in here. It's kind of... Actually, I shouldn't even be talking about it right now, to be honest.
We tore and burnt and took wax and took fake blood and took some sunflower seeds and, you know, rum and wine stains and, you know, everything we could think of. We kind of threw the kitchen sink at it to get that texture and detail. It weighed like 80 pounds. It's got 1,000 pages in it.
I feel like I pulled a tree stump out of the ground. I've been guesstimating the weight by trying to lift it. Too heavy for a prop.
I showed it to Gore and Johnny and got really good responses from them. So the next day we're going to go shoot it in first take. Keith had to open up the cover and he had to flip, I think, 3 pages. Nailed it great on the first take. By the second take, you know, 10 minutes in between or whatever, he goes to open it up and he, you know, can't get it open because the thing's so heavy. So he put it back down and he said, it's a movie, you know, the luggage never weighs as much. We went back behind the set and we took a saw and we cut half of it out. We cut all the extra pages.
The book that was constructed was a little too heavy to open. So we're cutting out the inside of the book.
Okay.
Pirate movies don't come along very often. So, you know, if you look back over history and how many pirate movies have been made, there's only a handful of prop masters that's had that opportunity. So when that opportunity presented itself, it doesn't get any better than that.
Thank you.
heck are we right now? This is a weird looking place.
We're in the middle of the Bonneville Salt Flats in Wendover, Utah.
Love Utah. Another day in the salt.
You can get disoriented in the salt.
So we'll be doing this with...
This is my friend.
Rock.
Yeah, people have gotten disoriented because it gets really hot.
Where do they all go? Where are they? Where's everybody?
Make sure you're hydrated all day long. Wear sunscreen constantly. Wear hats, sunglasses, and underwear.
So it's very important that you either wear some protective underwear or you have to get in there with the, you know, with the lotion.
Getting ready for round three on the soft flat.
Where's the camera? Let's go.
Oh,
action!
I'm doing rock work.
Yeah. We're trying to reintroduce rocks to this desert. It's a company called Salt Lake Rock Works. We were all not here then, but like some 2,000 years ago, that was full of rocks here.
Rock.
You know, like in the Pacific Northwest, you're getting the grizzly back, we're bringing the rocks back.
Directing is the only job.
So I think we are fairly successful with the reintroduction of the rocks into the salt lakes here. Overnight they're gonna start moving, and we have some, Rick has some transmitters on them, so we can follow their tracks, and
tracking the wild rock.
Now we're being followed by rocks. Never heard that before.
Yeah, it's a wrap here.
Done for the day on the beautiful salt flats of Bonneville.
Toe!
Another location down.
Basically, you have the pirates. It's like the Wild Bunch. You know, the pirates are like a dying breed, and modern times are coming in, industrialization, the trading companies taking over the ship routes, etc. So it's really, the pirates are like the revolutionaries, and they're trying to all gather in this movie. And let us show you the opening of the movie.
Talking about, you know, how to do this beginning, and very much, and actually, you know, we had this idea about the, you know, the hanging and the little boy.
They're hanging everybody who's ever been associated with pirates, and they're all up there, and they're, and then, you know, they bring them up, and there's a boy from a, I mean, either that or everybody's gonna walk out of the theater in the first 2 minutes. This was Hans's idea.
I'm not going to take entire credit for that part, just in case everybody hates it.
The king and his men stole the queen from her bed.
That evening, my wife was here as well, and she's not a singer or anything, and we just said to her, oh, can you just sing like a little boy, you know? And that sort of gave us, you know, the first instinct that it could work like that, you know, it could work by, you know, a young boy singing it, and that would be incredibly powerful.
Didn't suck, did it?
Hoist the Colors, Gore and I wrote together. I was in London doing Batman. Gore, I have no idea, I think he was at his house. We did the whole thing over iChat. This was technology at its best. He had to start shooting, and I'm a great procrastinator, so I hadn't done anything, and I finally get this phone call going, okay, get onto your computer, get onto iChat. I have a guitar here. We're gonna write this thing now. I just had a little piano in front of me, and seeing him in Los Angeles. And, you know, we were playing around with tone. We were doing it with fiddles and accordions and I don't know what else.
What?
No instrumentation. Oh. I'm just curious how it's going to sound. Just play. Yeah. Totally solo.
There's a code in the song. Huh?
Yes, okay. I can tell you exactly what these words are supposed to mean.
Looking for a bend and bounder in her bones. It's about Calypso being
bound in human form,
and they're going to release her. All together. She's getting out of her boat. It's the cause of evil. And then a voice comes in.
And beggar, never say we die.
A song unites the pirates, and when you hear the song, all the pirates are going to get together and basically fight corporate oppression.
Too long, the fate has not been in my own hands. No longer.
It gives you a good protagonist. It gives you a good story. The world has become a grimmer place, and it's like real life has caught up with us.
Right to legal counsel. Suspended.
It's just suddenly, you know, maybe we are looking at this, you know, at our silly romp in a slightly different light. I mean, that, you know, I'm very wary about what I'm saying here because, you know, you instantly can get very pretentious, and it really wasn't meant like that.
Gentlemen, hoist the colors.
Hoist the colors.
And remind them
that,
you know, let's not die silence.
Right.
And then someone else starts humming, the whole crowd starts singing. Yeah. And the redcoats are, you know, the East India Trading Company guys are like, what's happening here, you know? And they're marching up. Now they're, instead of scared, they're defiant. You can kill me, but the spirit of piracy is going to be here and to plague you forever.
As he who issued summons, I convene this, the Fourth Brethren Court.
Made up of the great pirate lords, the Brethren Court is what you might call the governing body of pirates.
This is madness.
This is politics.
The pirate lords' titles are based on the seas on which they hailed. These rogues and scoundrels were the best of the best, or the worst of the worst, depending on who you might ask. The pirate lords, hailing from around the world, have all been smart, lucky, and ruthless enough to survive and thrive. Entry to this club requires possession of one of the 9 pieces of 8.
What's the significance of that, I wonder?
Each captain holds this item close at all times, since it provides entry to this mighty exclusive group. From Marseille, the trading capital of France, the good Capitaine Cheval, lord of the Mediterranean Sea, spent years picking off the weak and wealthy trade ships of Europe. Cheval spent a good bit of his time between the Old World and the French Caribbean colonies. Having crossed paths with Villanueva of Spain, he also plundered the bountiful Spanish treasure fleets returning from Mexico and points due south. His piece of 8 is the Queen of Spades. The Queen of Spades trumps all others. Tis true, piracy along the China coast has a long and profitable tradition. Shanghai was the maritime capital, and Mistress Ching, Lord of the Pacific, made a comfortable living there. She had hundreds of vessels at her disposal and ruled with bloody terror all the way up and down the coast of China.
And we can pray that she will be merciful.
I rather doubt it.
Incredible to say, but she was completely without a sense of sight.
Missing too, by the sound of it.
Her men were notoriously nasty to their victims. They would behead them just as soon as look at them. Powerful to the end, she was one of the few pirate captains to retire proper. She set herself up in Canton, a wealthy lady. Her piece of eight? A pair of spectacles. Trading between the Arab world and India goes back thousands of years and has always been fruitful. Pirates sailed these waters and preyed on amply laden merchants. The rich ships of the East India Trading Company also ran through these waters, filled to the brim with booty from the Spice Islands and the Orient. Easy prey for pirates. This is where the pirate lord Sri Sumbaji, Lord of the Indian Ocean, ruled. Sri Sumbaji surely had his hands in a number of pots, being both a priest and a pirate lord.
Sri Sumbaji proclaimed this all to be folly. Who cares?
He had a man to speak for him, an interpreter, not because he couldn't speak many languages, but to mask his naturally delicate and ladylike voice.
And so, we shall go to war.
His piece of eight is a snuff box made from calf horn. Barbosa. Lord of the Caspian Sea, was first mate on the Black Pearl when Jack Sparrow was captain. Information's his treasure, a bedeviling schemer and horse trader. He tends to honor the pirate's code only when it suits him.
The code is more what you'd call guidelines, the natural rules.
No, he's not one to be trusted. He was the one led the mutiny against Jack and eventually became a pirate lord himself.
Yes, we know that one. Anything else?
Barbossa's lord of the largest enclosed body of water on Earth, sometimes called the world's largest lake. Known as the Caspian Sea, it borders Russia and Iran, among others. The northern portion freezes in the winter, but during the summer, it's hot as blazes. It's also a rich source of caviar, a favorite delicacy of Barbossa. Hector's piece of eight.
I kept it safe, just like you said when you gave it to me.
It's kept in a safe place by his crewman, Raghetti. It's the sailor's wooden eye. Spain, Lord of the Adriatic Sea, was a privateer who crossed swords with the Barbary corsairs and purloined trade from European ships from the Canary Islands. His partnering with the Spanish government allowed him a fine retirement of nobility among the European aristocracy. It's clear he crossed paths and swords with Capitaine Cheval.
Traitor, me?
I silence you!
As they shared an animosity as heated as the one between their countries, Spain and France. His piece of eight is the neck of a broken bottle, which helped him win a legendary and life-threatening bar fight. Jack Sparrow, Lord of the Caribbean. Aye, crazy like a fox he is.
You're mad.
Thank goodness for that, because if I wasn't, this would probably never work.
Of all the pirate lords, he's the quickest to seize the moment and make it his own.
Die!
Whether by cause or accident is a matter of debate.
It's got to be the best pirate I've ever seen.
But the results are the same and always different. Confused? That's just the way old Jack likes it. 'Tis common knowledge he's got the mark of the sparrow on his wrist. The symbol testifies that he sailed in all the oceans of the world, many times over. But he's got another mark, an ancient poem, the Desiderata it's called. It's tattooed on his arms, chest and back. His piece of eight? He acquired the Moroccan beads from a French lady of questionable reputation. And the coin, an ancient coin from Siam, one of the first two bits he ever pirated. The second bit, well, he bought his hat with that one. The little we know of Gentleman Jocard, Lord of the Atlantic Ocean, is that he was an escaped slave who took on the name of his former master. Quite the ladies' man he is. His charming presence clearly masks a sharp and brilliant mind. His home is New Orleans, a port known for its charitable and practical leanings towards piracy. His piece of eight is a tobacco cutter stolen from the plantation on which he was enslaved.
Cut out his tongue!
Some say he took a particular revenge using this very item. Truly is more to pirate lord and king Elizabeth Swan than meets the eye. And as the Chinese pirate Cao Feng said, the eye does not go wanton. She was born a governor's daughter, but she always has been a pirate at heart. When Cao Feng passed on, he handed her his piece of eight. It was then she rose to the rank of ship's captain.
Who among you do you name as captain?
Doing the title proud, she attended the meeting of the pirate lords and, as you know, was elected king. There be three qualities to becoming the pirate king. You must be captain of a ship, you must swear by the code, and you must have killed a man. Of course, as the newest addition to the Brethren Court, many of her legends have yet to be written and to be told. Miss Swan's piece of eight is the Jade Captain's Knot. The pirate lord of the South China Sea's mantle was passed down to him from his father. The fierce and battle-scarred Cao Feng's name means romantic warrior. The only man he ever risked his life for was Jack Sparrow. Course, Jack repaid him by stealing the hearts of his twin companions. All those loyal to Cao Fang are required to wear the tattoo of the dragon. The dragon's considered to be benevolent and good luck. Even the name of his ship, the Hai Pang, means flying dragon. With hundreds of ships and thousands of men in the docks and bathhouses of Singapore, he truly is a sleeping giant.
Weapons!
The government of China was always real strict about who they allowed their merchants to trade with, and so they made all their traders settle in certain areas, such as Macau. This made it mighty easy to plunder them on their way in and out of port. He holds one of the great keys to a true pirate mystery, the chart that shows the way to World's End. His piece of eight was made of silk from the famous Silk Road, which Marco Polo traveled, and jade, a traditional Asian gem. It's the Jade Captain's Knot. Armand the Corsair, Lord of the Black Sea, was one of the Barbary pirates who flourished during the Golden Age of Piracy. The wealthy caliphs of North Africa, heirs to the throne of Muhammad himself, had vast fleets of well-outfitted pirates, such as Armand, who would rob bountiful trade from wayward Christian infidels. Many Barbary pirates were one-time prisoners and galley slaves who advanced to the upper decks.
I vote for Armand, of course.
A pirate who combined his forces with the Ottoman Empire to control the region from Morocco to Turkey and beyond. His piece of eight is a pewter brandy goblet used by outcast sisters in a Spanish monastery. They was outcasts for a reason, and that reason was Armand the Corsair.